My name is Justin. I'm going to be the moderator this evening. I'm going to consider that a pretty good introduction on his part, so we're just going to let Bernie go ahead and introduce himself for a
couple minutes. Well, it's good if he does too, because for the camera, so.
Oh, okay. Do you want to do a part two, succinct reintroduction?
I'm Phil Smith. I'm a philosophy professor at George Fox University. This is not the first time that Bernie and I have debated. Part of our goal is to encourage public interest in what some people think are narrow academic topics. So welcome for all of you.
Okay, the short introduction. My name is Bernie, and I work at a large computer company. I don't mention names, they keep them out of this. They may not want to be associated with atheism, because believe it or not, there's a lot of Christians that work at a company, and they don't want, you know, their branding concerned with that. Anyway, since 1984, I've been working in high-tech computer field, and I've been a born-again evangelical Christian for over 25 years. I left the faith in 2007 after getting a seminary degree, and so in 2009, I actually became an atheist. And I wrote a book here too it's a booklet called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology, where I give my reasons why I left the faith. And I wanted with all my heart to remain a Christian if I could just find one thread to hang on to, and I couldn't find a thread, so I had to leave. So we can talk more about that in the Q&A time if you want to. So
The way that this debate has been set up, I haven't had a hand in that, that's between these two gentlemen, it's really audience-centered. I think we've left a lot of time for you guys to have hopefully some good questions and generate some good debate that will probably come back between these two gentlemen and also between you guys and both the speakers. So if you have questions, I encourage you, if you get a chance, to write them down throughout. Officially starting, you have 15 minutes.
15 minutes, I'm supposed to say, is belief in God warranted? He asked for a joke earlier. So obviously that's impossible, right? Very limited. There's a whole range of arguments that are sometimes given for belief in God. And I think lots of them are very interesting. I teach a course called Christian Apologetics. And we cover a lot of those arguments. But we cover a lot of arguments against the belief in God, and a lot of things. It's so complicated. What can you do in only 15 minutes? Well, I can give one little argument about one little part of one part of the debate. So if you're dissatisfied that I haven't persuaded you, I've told you up front that I'm not going to do it. I'm going to give one little part of one part of the argument. And what I'm going to do is say that we should reject what I'm going to call the epistemic prohibition on religious experience. Yeah. So let's see if I can advance it. This would be showing up on the wall very beautifully, except that we don't have the cable, and we haven't got the lights arranged properly either. So you just have to go with what I said. Out of all of the arguments, there's what, a cosmological argument and an ontological argument, and there's moral arguments, and there's arguments, all kinds of arguments that could be given for the existence of God. I want to talk about religious experience. But I'm not going to talk about all religious experience, or even my religious experience, or your religious experience. I'm going to talk about the prohibition against religious experience. First of all, I will just say, it's a fact, here it is. Human beings experience mystery. There's all kinds of things that they find that are deeply mysterious. Some of them we label religious, and some of them we label philosophical. Religious statements. So I'll start with some statements that kind of are sometimes used to say this expresses mystery. Actually, I think it's better to say that they point to mystery, because the point of mystery is that you don't have it all nailed down. Right? So Christians say God is to be thanked and praised. Hindus say Atman is Brahman. Jews say, the Lord is one. So these are statements from various religions that point to what I will call mysteries. But then there are questions which may also point to mysteries. Some of you have read the Gorgias. In the Gorgias, Socrates says that it is better to suffer for doing right than to do wrong to others. Callicles laughs at him. It is better to do evil to others than have evil done to you. The power to do to my enemy what I want is far better than to suffer the evil that my enemy does to me. Why is Socrates right and Callicles wrong? Now some people say, wait a second, Callicles is right. It is good to have power and get people. But you see what the question then is about morality. What is the nature of morality? Some months ago, that was the topic when Bernie and I debated, so we'll leave that alone. Another philosophical question, why is there something rather than nothing, Leibniz says. And for several hundred years since Leibniz, philosophers have been debating that one. It just seems to be a deep question. A scientist named Lawrence Cross, 2012, says that he can explain this. Okay, maybe he can. So that question will disappear if he's right, and Lawrence Cross's name will go down with Aristotle's. Eugene Wigner, 1960, asked, why is mathematics so effective in understanding the world? Mathematics, which is dreamed up and invented by human beings on one little planet in one corner of one galaxy, seems to be the key to understanding the whole wide universe and the microscopic subatomic universe. Some people are tempted to say, well, the reason math works is because it's real. We don't invent it, we discover it. It's kind of out there before we ever come. But of course, that's not helping with the mystery, because then you ask, how in the world does the universe have this math built in? Moving away from that, a different question. Alistair McIntyre points out that part of the good life for human beings, according to the Western tradition at least, is to ask, what is the good life? Which is an interesting thing. So that the good life apparently is not, as some philosophers suggested, like Aristotle, static. According to Aristotle, the good life for God is eternal contemplation of God's self. But most of us want to say that part of the good life is this continual conversation that we're having tonight. This is part of the good life, where we search for what the good life is. That seems to be mysterious. Anyway, okay. In this business of religious experience, or the experience of mystery, Martin Buber, a 20th century existentialist, Jewish existentialist, said that sometimes we have I-it relationships. But sometimes we have, he said, I-thou relationships, where we recognize a relationship to the other that is not impersonal and dead, but living and alive, responsive, the I-thou relationship. Now, of course, the perennial place for this is we discover this in human beings. There's a big difference between this and this. In fact, I can say this, but I should say the impersonal pronoun is almost inappropriate, isn't it? There is a thou there. And many people nowadays will resonate with what Buber says when we think of the I-thou relationship not just with human beings, but with other things as well. Perhaps an ecosystem, or the planet, or life itself. Okay, so far I've just stated what people have experienced, that they have experiences of mystery and the I-thou experience. And I want to suggest that religions take these experiences seriously. All religions? I'm not saying that. I don't know. You'd have to inquire into various religions. Is that all that there is to religion, to just experience mystery? Certainly not. There's other things going on besides mysteries. You have religious festivals where you dance and sing and pray and whatever. All I'm saying is that religions take the experience of deep mystery seriously. And they allow people to think that their experience of deepest mystery is an indicator, a pointer to reality. Scientism says otherwise. Now, be careful what I just said. I did not say science. Scientism is the belief that science will answer all questions eventually. As James Walsh put it, modern naturalism is kind of the belief in the omnicompetence of science. A completed science will answer all our mysteries in the end. Now, in reality then, there are no mysteries. There are only problems. And scientism believers love to emphasize that there are lots of problems, things for us to solve. But given 10 or 15,000 of modern science, years of modern science, way in the future when we've completed science, we'll have it all figured out. So now I can state the prohibition as I understand it. If you have had experience of mystery or I-thou experiences, except for human beings, you may not take your experience as an indicator of reality because science will give an adequate explanation of it at some time in the future in purely naturalistic terms. It's outlawed. You think, oh, come on, you just made that up. No, I'll give you three examples of the prohibition in action. You may think that your experience of mystery reveals reality, but in actuality, it is determined by your class. Karl Marx, 19th century. Economic factors will determine what you believe and what you experience. Actually, it reflects, Nietzsche says, no, that's an interesting idea, but you're wrong, Mr. Marx. It's really about will to power. Your experiences do not tell you about the real universe. All they reveal is your will to dominate. And of course, Freud says, no, both of those men are wrong. Your experience of the mysterious is your unresolved infantile neuroses that you have. However, so all of this is based on my definition of scientism, which is actually very widespread, I think. And in fact, I think there are a lot of people, I suspect there's a lot of people in the room who would affirm that all important questions will be answered by science, the omnicompetence of science. Unfortunately, science is not omnicompetent, and it cannot possibly be. The omnicompetence of science is unbelievable. Some examples. Start with the simple and move up. Just a few examples. Bertrand Russell said, imagine the village in Austria. Actually, I don't think it was Austria, but whatever. Imagine the village where there is a barber who shaves all and only those men who do not shave themselves. Got the village?
Mm-hmm.
No, you don't. There is a village where the barber shaves all and only those men who do not shave themselves. Does the barber shave himself? If he shaves himself, then he is not a man who does not shave himself, so he does not shave himself. But if he, you see how it works? The answer to this paradox is simple. This village cannot possibly exist. The description of the village creates a built-in contradiction. It's a kind of a basic logic test for students in logic. The village where the barber shaves all and only those men who do not shave themselves cannot possibly exist. So we haven't got a real problem yet. We've just seen how human language can create paradoxes.
You have 3 minutes.
3 minutes left, we're in trouble. Okay, moving on. There are determined but unpredictable processes. For instance, the three-body problem in physics. We measure how long the year is. I've had almost 60 orbits, and the orbits, my birthday's coming up next month, 60 orbits of the Earth around the Sun. And it's measured down, the astronomers can tell you down to very, very close precision what the length of the year is. Try looking up sometime what the length of the lunar month is. The answer will be, the usual average length of the lunar month is 29.53 days, but we don't have a formula that can solve the three-body problem. It's a deterministic problem. It's all Newton. Three bodies. It's all Newtonian forces, and yet we can't solve it. There are problems, and this is, well, then you move into chaotic systems that are even far, far more complicated. What we recognize is that there are deterministic systems, and yet they're beyond our ability, even given computers working a million years, to solve. And then there are undetermined processes in the universe, quantum dynamics. And then there are limits to logic and math itself. Gödel proved that there are undecidable propositions in any axiomatic consistent system. And Gödel's theorem G is one of those. His proposition G is one of those theorems. And it's true. Then there's also limits in social science, but I won't bother with that. Okay, given that there are limits to reason, there are no good reasons to accept the promise that mystery will be explained away. We noted that there were, in the 19th century, very persuasive arguments or voices that said that your religious experience will be explained away on the basis of economics, on the basis of your unresolved problems from your childhood, or on the basis of will to power, but they contradict each other and they're not persuasive. Conclusion: religious people act reasonably when they take their experiences of mystery and the I Thou as indicators of reality. Have I proven that God exists? No. I've only said that there is a class of evidence that ought to count that is usually forbidden. That's all.
Before I have Bernie start, I'd actually, if you wouldn't mind, if it's all right with you, if you could succinctly, like in a sentence, maybe give the audience, just for the clarity's sake, in the beginning you described you're going to talk about one small section, one small part, one small argument.
Yeah, that's right.
Specific
right.
To how that reacts to his faith in God warranted. Would you maybe give me a sentence so that they can hold on to your argument and something a little bit more succinct?
Lots of people have had this experience. They pray. They feel God. I know in my heart that Jesus loves me. Put it in the language of a 13-year-old. But now I read so-and-so. In 1910, I read Freud, Totem and Taboo, and he says all of this stuff, and therefore I can't believe that God is speaking to me. I'm saying Freud's argument is no good, and especially Totem and Taboo. But in general, the promise that we can explain away all of your experience is an empty promise. Your experience does count. That doesn't mean it overrides everything else. It doesn't mean it couldn't be overridden by something. You have to judge it along with many other things, but it does count.
Thank you. All right, Bernie, all you, 15 minutes.
Okay, and I have a handout here. Does everybody have a handout? Okay, there's extras over here if you need one. I do that so you can take notes and jog your memory when it's question and answer time. Okay, is faith in God warranted? Of course, I would say, of course not. It's not warranted. I mean, I think God is an imaginary character, just like Darth Vader or Harry Potter. You know, the stories that are written about him. So is faith in Darth Vader warranted? Of course not. So for me, it's the same exact level to talk about God, especially the God of the Bible, Yahweh, Jehovah, Jesus. You know, it doesn't matter if Zeus, Thor, whatever. Especially the God of the Bible, even more so. And then, of course, there's a different kind of gods. There's a philosopher's God, the deist God. So I'm going to try to focus pretty much on Phil's God here, the Christian God. First off, I want to mention points of agreement. Now, some of my things I'm going to say that some of my fellow atheists would probably disagree with, and so that's fine. I'll give you another viewpoint. One thing is, I'm going to give you the definition of faith from the dictionary, Oxford Dictionary. Some positive aspects of faith. I do believe there are some positive and negative expressions of faith. And I'm going to make the claim that faith can be in line with evidence in some cases. And people can place faith in the wrong things. So for definition, this is the Oxford English Dictionary. Number one, complete trust or confidence in someone or something. Like, this restores one's faith in politicians. Or you can say, this restores my faith in God. So that's kind of what we're talking about. That's part of it. Another second definition is strong belief in God or in the doctrines of a religion that are based on spiritual apprehension rather than proof. And this is, I think, what Phil was mentioning, spiritual apprehension, this feeling of having Jesus in your heart. So, for example, the Christian faith. Well, I don't really think we're not talking about the Christian faith. We're not talking about faith in that way. But another version of this was, for example, it says a strongly held belief or theory, such as the faith that life will expand until it fills the universe. There are some people that think that life is so forward biased that someday life will spread through the entire universe, and that's their faith. You know, they have faith in that. So that's kind of, I think, the kind of faith we're talking about here, too. Okay. So I want to mention what I think are some positive aspects of faith. At work, one time we worked on a very difficult project. Everybody, all the engineers thought it was impossible. And in fact, we used this language to begin with, that it was impossible. And then I noticed that the engineers' language changed. Instead of saying impossible, they said, this is a challenging problem. And I thought, why are they saying it's challenging? Why don't they just say it's impossible? And then it dawned on me, it's like, you know, if I was the manager and they said it's impossible, why shouldn't I fire them and hire somebody else that says, sure, I can do it? So, and it turned out on this project, it was a big project. It was kind of a moonshot type of project. And it panned out, and it made my company a lot of money. And, you know, after thinking about this, I also realized there are some cases where, you know, small projects have failed, too. But anyway, I just want to say this is a positive aspect of faith. If you really believe, like Obama, you know, when he's running for president, who are you? You're a young guy. You're inexperienced. You're barely a senator. You'll never be president. And if he has a faith in himself to go and do all this stuff, that he can make it, look what happens. He became president, all because he had faith in himself. There is no facts for this. He had to move out on faith. So faith can be very powerful in a positive way. And faith can be in line with evidence. And sometimes there's people, some of the scientists joke that, this is a quote attributed to Max Planck, one of the great scientists. He said, science advances one funeral at a time. This is because some of the scientists can't give up on their hypothesis, even when it's been proven wrong. So, you know, a scientist should be impartial, and when his hypothesis is falsified, he should move on. But sometimes they like their hypothesis so much that they'll cling on to it. And sometimes that's good, because sometimes it looks like there is disconfirming evidence, but later on more evidence does come in to support it, and then they can figure out why that disconfirming evidence is explainable, because maybe there's other things they've learned that explains it now. So, you know, so there is faith in science in your hypothesis. I don't see anything wrong with that. Unless it's to the extreme where you should drop it and you don't because of your faith. So people can place faith in the wrong things. Hopefully this is something that Phil would agree with. You know, this is his own group I'm talking about. This is all, I mean, he says he's a Christian. He associates with Christians. Let me tell you what some of the most famous Christians on TV do. There's this guy, one guy named Peter Popoff. You know, he was disqualified and he's back on paid TV now. But, you know, here's an advertisement. The Lord's time for canceling debts has been proclaimed, Deuteronomy 15. You know, so call for your free miracle spring water and your anointed faith tool. Is faith in God warranted? Well, here's a faith tool. You can get a faith tool. I mean, it could be a cloth that's anointed or something. Look how they distort this. And I hope Phil has a righteous anger about this. He should. Because, I mean, this is destroying the Christian faith because it's such nonsense. Here's another example on TBN. I mean, maybe the Christians should get together and put all their money and put it into TV and proclaim the gospel. Well, that's what they're doing on TBN. And here they got people on their fundraising. It says, a preacher exhorted viewers to bellow, fear not, three times, count down from 10, and then rush to the phone with donations. In exchange, he said they would receive a miracle from God about this time tomorrow. Within seconds, all 200 phone lines were busy. This is Christians putting their money to preach the gospel, and this is what they're doing. Again, Phil should be upset about this. He should be very incensed about this, but I don't ever sense this from any of the Christian leaders and professors. People place faith, you know, in this holy scriptures. What holy scriptures? Well, the Bhagavad Gita, or the Holy Quran, or the Book of Mormon, or the Holy Bible. You know, it's all the same, right? They just have different degree of claims they're making. This is I said that, you know, they can place their faith in wrong things, like imagine you're an invisible characters, and here's God. You know, and I'm using this, you know, because sometimes atheists make fun of Christians. They say, "Oh, I don't believe in Sky Daddy," and Christians say, "Why do you say Sky Daddy? That's in a, you know, that's just mocking us." And it's like, "Well, look at this stained glass. Looks like there's this, you know, Father God in heaven above the clouds. There's the Holy Spirit there, and that's either God the Father or Jesus up there in the sky. You know, that's what happened in Acts. Jesus ascended up into the sky, up into heaven, past the clouds. What?" That's where heaven was. They said that's where heaven was, up there past the clouds. And that's why the story says he ascended up to heaven. And an angel said, "You know what? God, Jesus is going to return from heaven the same way. He's going to return from the sky." Okay, well, nowadays, of course, Christians don't say heaven's up there in the sky. I mean, some might. I know there's some Christians who still think hell is literally in the belly of the earth. I mean, look at, you got molten, you know, metals there. That's hotter than hell, you know. That must be where hell is. But nowadays, Christians say, "Oh, you know, heaven and hell are different dimensions," you know. Well, you know, Acts wasn't written with that in mind. So why is faith in God not warranted? I'll give four reasons here, and I'll go into details. Can you see how much time I got? If you can keep that on, it's kind of nice for me. I can kind of watch it. So the burden of proof is on the claimant. I'm going to explain what that means. But there's a burden of proof is a philosophical concept. The null hypothesis is a scientific concept. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. It's a nice proverb, and it's kind of that's more of a philosophical concept for logical thinking, critical thinking, same with the burden of proof. God evidences are usually guilty of being logical fallacies. That's my claim. Logical fallacies are a major component that they teach you in critical thinking. So that's a philosophy thing. So let me talk about the burden of proof. It's on the claimant. So which religion of all competing religions is true? You know, a lot of Christians, they're like, "Hey, accept Jesus." It's like either Jesus or nothing. You know, either an atheist or you believe in Jesus. Wait a minute. Look at the whole smorgasbord. I mean, if you were born in Iran, people might think it was Islam or nothing. You know, or if you're in India, maybe it was Hinduism or nothing. But you got all these religions to compare. So why don't you treat them all as an equal opportunity? And John Loftus is a guy, he's a former Christian too, and he says, Jesus, outsiders test the faith. Test each one of these as an outsider, not like a believer of one of them that has confirmation bias and wants to prefer his own. Step outside and look at them all equally and say, which one makes the most sense? If you're going to make a claim, the burden of proof is on you. If I say I have a million zebras living in my garage and, you know, you want to buy one? They're only $1,000 each. I mean, why would you buy one if you don't go take a look at it? And why would you even believe them if I said I had a million of them? Because obviously I can't have a million in my garage, you know? So if I'm going to make a claim, I should have a burden of proof. And that's why we need logic and reason to sort it out. You can't just say, go by your feelings. Come on, you don't believe me I have 1,000 zebras in my garage? See what your heart tells you. Come on, pray about it. That's God. No, you don't appeal to your emotions like that. Would I lie to you? Come on, what kind of feelings do you get here? That's what a mass murderer would say, or somebody, you know, it's like, "Hey, come on to my house. You know, I'm a nice guy." Yeah, okay, you got a nice feeling? What is the null hypothesis? The null hypothesis is a very interesting scientific concept. A lot of scientists don't even know about this, but the null hypothesis is the standard hypothesis. And when you create a new hypothesis, your goal is actually supposed to be to overturn the null hypothesis. So for example, at one point, let me give you, there's various ways of looking at this, but one of the most obvious ways is like, if I say, here's a pill, this will cure cancer, pay me $1,000 for it, okay? The null hypothesis is, this does not cure cancer. If you want to overcome that null hypothesis, you have to show with statistics, through testing, double-blind testing, placebo, that my pill is better than a placebo. Otherwise, I have not beaten the null hypothesis, okay? So the null hypothesis, me and Phil agree there's a natural world. We agree that if I drop this, it's gonna fall to the ground. That's all natural. But he wants to go, somebody might go over more than that and say, no, there's really angels that bring that down, and someday they may bring it up, you know? It's like, well, okay, if you have these additional supernatural things, then you should try to beat the null hypothesis. They can't beat the null hypothesis because whenever you put a camera or anything on it, it's all natural. The whole system is working natural. There's no miracles that can be captured on film or tape or testing or anything. Prayer studies, anything you name, anything you try to test fails when it comes to supernatural. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. There's a famous person that says you should apportion belief to evidence. The more the evidence, the more you can believe it. Okay? If you want me to believe you're an American citizen, no problem. It doesn't really ask much of me. I can believe that, okay? But if you want me to believe that you're a prophet that talks to God, and God told you to tell me something, and I need to change my life based on that, I'm sorry, but you're going to have to give me some evidence, okay? So, you know, the extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. The more you claim, the more you want from me, the more you better prove it, okay? And it's not going to be just asking me how I feel about my heart. And one of my claims is that God evidences are usually guilty of being logical fallacies, appeal to emotion. This is a huge one. This is the core of Phil's argument tonight about feelings. I used to be a Christian. I had the feelings. I thought I was led by God. I thought I had a relationship with Jesus. That's why I said I didn't want to give this up. I now know it's a delusion. Just like it's a delusion if you're in a desert and you see an oasis. Yeah, you see that. You really do see it. But it's not true. It's not real. I've had that delusion. If Phil says he feels the Holy Spirit, I felt it. I know exactly what he's talking about. And that's why I didn't want to give it up. I wanted it. I said, just give me one thread. And I could not, after learning science and philosophy, I could not find one thread to hold on to. Phil just has logical fallacies. The appeal to emotion is the biggest worst one right here on display. He also mentioned the appeal to ignorance. Why is there something instead of nothing? We don't know. Therefore, it's evidence for God. No, it's not evidence for God. It's evidence you don't know. It's not evidence for either side. It's another major logical fallacy. And so that's the appeal to ignorance. And then there's just poor arguments. I'm going to skip that one because I think I'm running out of time here. I might get back to that. So in conclusion, I would say I was a born-again evangelical Christian for over 25 years. Before that, I was raised a Roman Catholic. I was confirmed as a Roman Catholic. But the last 25 years, up until 2009, I was a born-again evangelical Christian. Working full-time in the computer industry the whole time, on the side, did an internet Christian ministry, preached the gospel on TV, cable TV, and all that stuff. The more I learned about science and philosophy, I came to see that the naturalistic worldview made sense of everything. When you're a Christian, you're going to say, well, how do you explain the problem of evil? And, you know, there's so many problems in Christianity and theology because it doesn't make sense. And the answer is always, well, someday we'll go to heaven and find out. Well, when you have a naturalistic worldview, kabam, it all makes sense. Seriously, I don't have any philosophical contradictions whatsoever. And in Christianity, it's just loaded left and right. I see belief in God as a God delusion. I'm here to break the spell. I hope that I help get you guys out of that too. And I want to encourage you to seek truth more than no matter what, higher than anything else. Let the consequences fall. But we don't want to believe in Santa Claus just because it makes us feel good. We don't want to believe in God just because it makes us feel good.
I'm going to do the same thing I did for you, Bernie, mm-hmm. but I did for Phil, and if you could kind of succinctly just to cover that last 15 minutes, but
sure.
Maybe as close as you can to a sentence or a couple sentences, why is faith in God not warranted?
Okay, yeah, the reason why faith in God is not warranted is because, number one, there is no evidence for it, and number two, the evidence presented for it by people like Phil tonight are logical fallacies.
All right, guys, there's probably plenty to chew through right now for both of them that you may agree or disagree with. So keep up the notes and the question taking. We're going to move into a 10-minute interchange between the two of them. I'm going to be a little bit more liberal with this because this is the most important part. They're going to bring up stuff that they just didn't think about in the beginning. So with your guys' permission and with their permission, you know, it'll probably be a little bit more than just 10 minutes, and then we'll roll into the Q&A section. So, Bernie, why don't you go first?
Yeah, I'll start because Phil started with the presentation, so I can question it. Now, let me just give a little introductory thing, too, about this. Also, the way this works well, too, is like the person who... See, I'm gonna interrogate Phil, basically, and then he's going to have the turn to interrogate me. And the point is for me to ask him questions, and if I feel like he's going astray or something, I could shut him down and try to redirect him. So it's not being rude. It's just trying to say, look, I want to get this answer, and they're not giving me what I think, okay? And then when you turn the tables, of course, you can do the same to me. So it's the way that, like, you know, I don't want to just ask a question and get a sermon and a response, okay? So just to let you know that the person doing the question is in the driver's seat. And hopefully they're going to be asking questions and not using that time to do a sermon or their own presentation. I feel so. Okay, so Phil, it seemed to me like your main point was really, like I said, a logical fallacy. Why is that not a logical fallacy to go by feelings?
I think people should pay attention to all evidence that they can find. It seems to me that there are views in science, which you have repeated several times, that rule out some evidence. There cannot possibly be evidence in this area, so we won't look. A person's feelings are quite important, right? It gives you evidence about lots of things.
Do you know that there's a logical fallacy called the Pilgrim Motion?
Yes.
So
there's variations of it. How does it work? Let's take Misericordium, the appeal to the emotion of pity.
Hold on. So, yeah, can you briefly tell me what the appeal to emotion is and why this does not fall in that?
You say, you have this emotion, so this thing over here is true, or this thing over here is false. The classic case is the child who has murdered her parents and pleads for mercy from the court because she's an orphan. So the emotion of another person doesn't have anything to do with the truth or falsity of whether or not I did something right or wrong. So there is a fallacy here that's sometimes called appeal to, there are various appeals to emotion. But I'm not making that fallacy. I'm not saying God exists because I have certain feelings. I would be saying God exists because it's the best explanation for certain experiences that people have.
Okay, so let me ask you a question about that. When I was an evangelical Christian, I was talking to Mormons because I wanted to convert them. And they told me to pray about the Book of Mormon and I'll get a burning in the bosom. Mm-hmm. I prayed about the Book of Mormon and I got a burning in the bosom. Mm-hmm. And in my mind, it's like, here's what happened. When I prayed, I got the feeling, and this is exactly what happened. Within about 3 or 4 or 5 seconds, my first thought was, okay, Bernie, I guess you're a Mormon. And my second thought was, wait a minute, you can't be a Mormon with what you know. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if I use that feeling, I would have been totally deluded.
No, you used it properly. You weighed one bit of evidence against other evidence. And I emphasized this earlier, I was only defending the rational applicability of one narrow band of evidence that has to be sorted along with lots of others.
Okay, so but because I studied Mormonism and knew about the manuscripts and knew about so much of their history, my brain was able to know that it was false. But my heart, if I didn't know that, if I was a regular Mormon, because I taught the Mormons who don't even know their own history, if I was a regular Mormon and just prayed and got that feeling, They cry with such emotion about how true it is to them. Mm-hmm. But they're deluded, right?
Well,
you agree they're deluded.
This experience shows you how important it is to continue learning and not depend on one feeling as the end of the world. Mm-hmm. You ought to do. And the fact that I'm here, the fact that I teach philosophy classes, that lots of other things that I do, I push religious people to keep learning.
Okay, so do you agree with me that Mormons are deluded when they get a feeling that they think is from God to validate the Book of Mormon?
I think that's a confused question. I think Mormon theology is seriously heterodox. That's a nice, polite, modern way of saying it's heresy. Because we don't burn people at the stake anymore. No. We have grown up a little bit. So I think that Mormon theology is in error. Does that mean that I think this Mormon person does not know God? No, I do not conclude that at all.
Okay, let me try to be really focused here. A Mormon prayed to God mm-hmm. to give a sign, mm-hmm. a burning in the bosom, mm-hmm. if the Book of Mormon is true, mm-hmm. and they got that burning in the bosom.
Yes.
Is that burning in the bosom a delusion? Or is it really from God? I mean, those are only two choices.
It's not only two choices. It could well be from God, and they misunderstand it.
You think God would give them a burning in the bosom for a non-true book?
I think no. God wants them to know that He loves them. He's reaching out to them. The fact that they interpret it according to the cultural categories that they've been given is true of lots of people. There are people who God communicates with who interpret it, unfortunately, in terms of the violence that they've been trained into. We saw this today. People very eager to serve God, but their understanding of God's will is warped.
Okay, I just want to belabor this a little bit, because it seems to me the Mormon is saying very specific question, nothing very general. It's very specific. Dear God, if this Book of Mormon is true, send me a burning in the bosom.
Yeah.
That's not if you are existent or anything. It's very specific about the Book of Mormon, and then they get the feeling. So,
I agree with you that the Book of Mormon is not divinely inspired. It was written by Joseph Smith, which is completely against Mormon theology, right? So I agree with you that they are missing the point. To say that they are deluded kind of makes it sound like they are something that, now we're borrowing Peter Boghossian's language, that the faith is a cognitive sickness.
Nope, totally different. Okay.
Delusion is not a cognitive sickness.
A delusion means you're seeing something that's not there.
Okay.
Like for example, you can have a delusion in the desert. You see an oasis and it's not there.
Usually we call this an illusion, an optical illusion, not a delusion.
Okay, but I mean, if you really believe it, somebody could say that guy's deluded and he thinks there's a lake over there. So he's deluded because he believes the optical illusion.
If we can somehow remove the denigrative language of putting down Mormons, I would say, yeah, I think you're right. There is something wrong with the Mormons' experiment.
But this is not about putting down Mormons. It's specific it's specific about that case. What I'm trying to say is you say that feelings are really important, and I'm giving you a case where they get the very strong feelings that you exactly are talking about, yet you know it is not from God.
How do I know that? Because I have, as you did, measured it against other things. So what we ought to do, rather than calling them deluded poor sots, we ought to help them see other evidence that will help them to come to the conclusion themselves.
Well, I think it's kind of amazing that you think that they would pray to God for a burning in the bosom, and God gives it to him, and God tries to say, and somehow blame it on them that they're not interpreting it correctly. I mean, I would think it'd be obvious. God would say, I would withhold that feeling. Then you'll start looking somewhere else. I mean, as soon as He gives them that feeling,
and
they're going to
God
get
does
deeper
this,
in.
He withholds the feeling from them, and you will say that this now is not evidence either.
Well, the thing is, when you know Mormon, this testimony is the strongest thing they have. They lean on it with all their might. You know, if you say, why are you Mormon? Because I have the burning in the bosom. I have this thing. Okay. The other thing is, I mean, then we have an agreement that emotions cannot determine truth in any way.
No, we do not have that agreement.
But you said you need to also look at other evidence. For example, I had a burning in the bosom, but it was worthless because I had knowledge.
No, I did not say it was worthless. I said it was old. It was real evidence. That was. You have to balance this evidence against this evidence, and sometimes this evidence over here overweighs this one.
But it's not even evidence. It's a delusion.
No, I disagree.
A delusion is evidence?
No, real emotional experience of mystery can be real evidence.
So do you think my feeling for the Book of Mormon is evidence for the Book of Mormon? I don't get it. How can you call that evidence?
Because it's evidence. It seems to lead to this. If this was the only evidence you had, it would be reasonable on the basis of this evidence to say that this is probably true. But you have defeaters for it.
Yeah, and since I got the defeaters, I now
that
know.
It doesn't remove the other evidence.
But once I have the defeaters, now I know that is not evidence.
No, 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 no. That is not right. It doesn't remove the evidence. It just outweighs it.
But it also disqualifies it. You can say that evidence is no longer valid.
It disqualifies the conclusion. It doesn't disqualify the evidence.
So when I got that feeling, I'm thinking that that feeling is a total delusion that my mind came up with. But you're saying it could actually be from God, and God was trying to tell me something else.
We have experiences of deep mysteries. Some of us think they come from God. They tell us something about God. I'm protesting against a view that says none of them ever count for anything. That's all.
I'm going to pause there because your time's up. You focused a lot on one question.
And
I would like to give you at least 2 minutes with your to kind of give multiple points to kind of ask another question. So go ahead.
Okay.
Go ahead and pick one of those bad boys. We'll do about two and a half minutes if we can.
I like that you take ownership there, right?
Hopefully. I want to do it earlier.
He's earning the big bucks.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. I get paid by the minute. Why stop?
So the other thing is, okay, so it sounds like, okay, emotion is one thing you can consider for evidence, and then there's also other things. And it seems like some of this other things you brought up is what I'm calling the appeal to ignorance. For example, you said, why is there something rather than nothing? Who knows? What does that have to even do with the topic?
I was giving an example of issues in the history of philosophy and religion that point to the experience of mystery that people have. Many people, theists, atheists alike, have said, for instance, Albert Einstein, the great question is not that this is the way, the world is the way it is, but that there is a world at all. These people feel a sense of awe and mystery,
right,
and that there is anything. Now, and I pointed out that a certain physicist has come along 2 years ago and claimed that he's going to solve this by physics, if he really has. I'm deeply skeptical. I haven't read his book, but I'm deeply skeptical.
I just don't see what all this has to do with faith, though. What's big deal? It's a mystery. Scientists deal with mystery all the time. So
no,
what?
No, they don't. You missed the distinction I made. Scientists deal with problems, not mysteries.
So they're trying to unravel mysteries.
No, problems.
Mysteries and problems.
A mystery is something that we recognize is beyond our ability to solve.
Okay. Oh, that's a sign stopper. We can never solve this problem. Don't even bother going there. It'd be a waste of time.
No, I didn't say that at all.
Well, if you can't solve it, why would you go there?
Because you experience it.
No, why would you try to? But you said you can't understand it, so it,
no, you
be,
can't understand it by means of science.
Right. So it would be a mistake for science to try to understand that.
Well, unless we were wrong.
That's called the science stopper.
Unless we were wrong. Suppose this guy who says that he has solved the problem that has bothered people from Descartes through Einstein. Suppose he has solved it. Well, more power to him. I'm deeply skeptical, but we, you know, there's no harm in trying.
But there is harm. If it truly was impossible to solve, it'd be stupid to try to waste your time on it. That's why to say these things will never be solved, it's a negative attitude. It's a science stopper, and it's very dangerous to science, and this is one of the things that atheists rightly oppose.
Wait a second, then. Are you going to say the same thing? For instance, take the incompleteness of arithmetic. Is this somehow a blow against mathematics that we proved that arithmetic has unprovable theorems that are true?
You can't prove that things are unprovable. That's crazy.
Read it.
No, you can't prove that anything's unprovable.
Gödel's theorem does exactly that. It's part of the key part of mathematics, has been since 1931. Look it up.
But it seems like all science breaks. I mean, there's all these people saying this can never be done. We'll never fly a guy to the moon. We'll never do this. We'll never do that.
People have said many things like that were badly placed. That's true. And so many times people, when they appeal to mystery, actually are making we should have both made this point clear. They're actually making an appeal to what is called the God of the gaps. This comes from the early days of worrying about evolution. You've got the fossil record with lots of fossils in it, but you seem to have, quote, gaps between this species and this species. And so conservative religious believers sometimes say, you see, there's a gap. And so that's where God stepped in and did it. And then, unfortunately, from their point of view, 20 years later, we find the fossils for the the intermediate species. And so the idea of God at the gaps can be ridiculed, that we're bringing in God only for the places where we have ignorance. The things that I mentioned, Gödel's proof of the incompleteness of arithmetic, are not God of the gaps type things. They're going to be around here 15,000 years from now.
I'm going to pause it there just because we're kind of getting away from the faith base, and I want to encourage both of you guys. The topic is faith in God warranted? I know that you're providing good context, but I want to make sure it stays as close to that as possible.
I just want to make one comment too, just a short one, is that I personally believe you should never say anything is impossible. I mean, unless it's logically impossible or something, but when it comes to science, you don't want to have that kind of attitude.
Well, you would admit that Russell's village is impossible.
The barber.
Okay, that's. I thought that was just kind of semantics and getting into too much.
It is, and it's a basic problem in self in reflexive language, where language refers to itself. You get these things. Whenever you have a language that can refer to itself, it's possible to produce these self-reflexive paradoxes. That's a silly one. All it means is the village doesn't exist.
Have you started your time now?
Okay. You said that when a person is comparing religion A to religion B to religion C, you should step outside. Now, I want you to explain this to me, but first I want to make an analogy to it. Somebody is comparing marriage practices in India to marriage practices in Africa to marriage practices in Europe, and they're trying to determine which is, I don't know, the best or the most reproductively successful marriage practice. What does it mean culturally to step outside? There's a point here, and it's a point that's been made by lots of philosophers in the last century, that when somebody asks you to step outside of being a human being, he's asking you to do something that's impossible. As Kierkegaard once said about Hegel, the philosopher should wake up and realize that he eats breakfast.
Let me do a quick answer. I think you're confusing things here. Science, we're trying to talk about what's real, what exists. Does God exist? And if he exists, then you can put faith in him. If he doesn't exist, of course, it'd be crazy to put faith in him. So we're talking about things about existence. We're not talking about culture, like what's the right culture. Cultures are different. By definition, there's almost...
But you said about the religions that you can have, I'm assuming, you can have some place to examine the religions that is fair to them and not within them.
Well, don't you think it's obvious if you're going to choose your own religion instead of just taking what you were born with, that you have to look at all of your choices and figure out what's best to you?
Yes.
Isn't that obvious?
Yes.
So what's the question?
The question is, you said that you could do this from what I'm calling a very mythical, non-existent intellectual place of being outside.
Hi, how can I call you?
Right.
So the whole point...
And when it comes to... I made the analogy to culture because it helps illustrate it. Some people think that, we can... This is a problem with cultural anthropology. We can understand this culture and this culture and culture, this culture. We understand all the cultures because we of course don't have a culture. The same thing is happening here. We can examine this religion and this religion, or you could say this faith and this faith and this faith, but of course we don't have a faith.
Okay, well, see, again, I think you're talking about cultures, which is, I think that's irrelevant. For example, when a Catholic says, look, in our religion, we take the body and blood of Jesus. Here it is. And you go, well, that's like a wafer to me. No, it's literally the body of Jesus. Okay, that's what you believe. All right, what do you Hindus believe? I mean, you can look at all the different people, including the atheists, who don't believe any of the religious stuff, and see which one makes the most sense. It's not about culture. It's about reality. Which makes the best sense about reality because they're making reality claims.
I'm going to, 2 seconds. I don't really have the right to do this, but I'm just going to do this for the sake of our participation's sake, since the question and answer section is so large. If I can clarify, and I could be wrong, what both of these gentlemen are saying in debate is essentially if you had a general worldview, which only has so many worldviews, that we kind of live, exercise, weigh, challenge what we see and feel and hear about the world. If I want to stop and say there's this kind of sense of, I think believe the terms of false neutrality, the sense that you can step outside of your worldview to therefore judge without bias any other worldview, then
that's
you're doing
good
so.
You should have asked my question for me. That's
sorry. You're doing so from a worldview to do that. So there is this kind of sense that there's this bias that doesn't exist. I believe they're both saying that.
No.
From different perspectives.
No, he's claiming to have actual neutrality, which I don't believe exists.
I'm familiar with that. But I want them to understand what you're saying, and that way they can better understand what Bernie's trying to say. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Time stops, so I'm not trying to steal anybody's time. We're back on.
I'll just say why I think you're wrong. Of course, we all have a bias that we have, but there's a thing called confirmation bias, which if you're a Christian and say, I'm going to look at all the other religions and I'm going to come from my Christian aspect, of course it's all colored. But obviously, I looked at all the different things from an unbiased position because I left. I saw atheism as better than Christianity, and I was a Christian.
I'm not trying to team up on anything. I just want to make sure that was clear. That's not a Christian-specific viewpoint.
But what I'm trying to say is there's a term here called confirmation bias, which is countering what you're talking about.
Confirmation bias is a real problem. I wouldn't deny it. Conversions happen. Certainly don't deny that. But the idea that we have a neutral viewpoint from which to examine these questions is simply wrong. Next question. Okay. You say that there is absolutely no evidence for the existence of God.
No good evidence, right?
Oh, no, that's not what you said. You said no evidence. Now what do you mean by good evidence?
Well, I mean, the evidence that the Christians give are usually logical fallacies. So
earlier
really
you said there, again you say usually logical fallacies.
Yeah.
So, this is mind-boggling.
Well, give me one piece of evidence. I'll tell you what's wrong with that. I'll probably tell you what logical fallacy it is.
All right. One that I don't think is particularly great, but I'll go with it. The ontological argument. How does it go? In some possible world, maximal excellence is instantiated. That's the premise.
What?
Yeah, basically the ontological argument is that God is the best at everything.
Well, that's the first premise. That's the only premise, by the way. In some possible world, maximal excellence is instantiated.
Okay.
Now, of course, we have to ask, what is maximal excellence?
Okay, now, wait a minute. Didn't I start the question off by saying what evidence? What's your best evidence?
Well, do you agree with the ontological argument doesn't use empirical evidence. It uses a conceptual
It's a philosophical argument.
Right, and it starts with the idea that maximal excellence is instantiated in some possible world.
Okay.
Where you have to make a basic decision about modal logic. Is it possible in some possible world?
The whole thing about the ontological argument is it's all based on the imagination.
No, it's based on one premise.
I know, but imagine there's a God who's the best of all possible worlds. I mean, it's all imagination. Imagine the best pizza. Imagine the best anything. I mean,
a difference in category between best pizza and best possible being?
Yeah, it's the same, but it's just imagination.
No, this is back to Ganilo and the best South Sea Island. And no, you're missing the modal point. Let's move.
Would you like more physical evidence?
No, I'm just saying, give me any evidence whatsoever. And this evidence is not evidence. It's philosophy, and the premise is all in the imagination. It's imagine there's something that's the best possible world. I mean, everything about it is all just imagination.
I'll help you out. What you should say at this point, people, it's a tricky argument because it has a silly beginning. What you should say is, no, that's not possible. In no possible world is maximal excellence instantiated. Which actually is philosophically interesting because it means that God is either a necessary being or an impossible being.
Maybe you should define what evidence is.
Oh, that's a very good question.
Well, I understand he's getting philosophical evidence. I'm saying the problem with that is the whole premise, it's all built in the imagination. It's starting with the imagination that there's this best possible God making the best possible world. I mean, it's just a mind game.
I'm going to have you move to your next question. You've got 3 minutes left.
How about empirical evidence?
Yeah, empirical. Well, he would also say, I'm sure he would say, that there's no empirical evidence at all as well. But then he would retreat to saying, there's no good empirical evidence, so it's all about how you are going to explain away the empirical evidence. For instance, the empirical evidence that any one of you might have had, this is nice because it returns us to the theme. The empirical evidence that you have of deep mystery in the universe. When you're, let's say you're contemplating Gödel's theorem and you're thinking, my gosh, there is an infinite number of things that we will never ever know, and yet they're true. How did the world get that way? Or you're contemplating the mystery that Eugene Wigner pointed out to us. Human beings have invented math, and it seems to be cool. How did we get such a cool thing?
You see all these questions you're doing? How did this happen? How did this happen? As if that's evidence for God. That's called the argument from ignorance. It's not evidence for God or against God. It's not evidence either way.
And so you see what the answer is. No matter what evidence you give, it's explained away. It's not allowed as possible evidence.
Well, you know what? You know what
I
the
think
logical
he's looking for something a little bit more.
No, I mean, that's a classical scientific logical fallacy. You know what the argument from ignorance is. I don't know why you don't understand that. That's an application of it. You can't say the world is like a woman holding a little baby. Oh, this is a miracle from God. Look at it. It's so obvious. This couldn't happen by nature. That's the argument from ignorance.
Perhaps I should be wrong. You pointed to, for a moment, to examples of religious hypocrisy. Is this really examples, is this offered as an example that, as an argument, you're offering this as an argument that religions are false? There are hypocritical religious people, therefore religions are false?
No, my point was that there's good, faith can be good or bad based on what it's placed in. I want to give it, I gave examples of both good and bad, and that was an example of bad faith, and I also gave examples of good faith.
Now, this is not a critical question. This is really just an exploring question, because it goes back to your example of the scientists or technologists who were trying to solve a problem. What's the difference? And I'm very serious about this, because I'm working on this. What's the difference between, in your understanding, between faith and hope?
Well, if hope means you don't know what's going to happen. Like, I hope he does okay. I hope the best for him. But faith is, it's like, I'm going through this, and I'm going to put my faith in it. I mean, it's kind of...
I'm working on this. Lily Poyman, who's a philosopher at West Point, says that he's not a Christian believer. He grew up as a Catholic, like you did. He's not a Christian believer. He cannot affirm that he has faith. But he just says, I hope that it's true. And he says, you know, when Judgment Day comes, you know, all I can confess is that I hope that it's true.
Bernie's phase went for 12 minutes. We're at 10 minutes, 18 seconds, so I'm going to let you go to 12 minutes.
I think I want these people to ask that question.
So you're done?
Yeah.
I'll tell you something I learned. I got some stories when I was a Christian, and I actually...
You want to
yes, a little bit on that. I learned some things as a Christian, and as an atheist, I still believe it, okay? So, because I think they're true, and it makes sense. Just one story about faith. One preacher once said that, I'm not sure if it's exactly about faith and hope, but it's kind of more of a story about what faith is. He was saying one time that, let's say, for example, there's a guy who's going to go across Niagara Falls, and he's going to tie a rope, and he's going to say, I'm going to put a person in this wheelbarrow, and we're going to go across on a tightrope. Okay, do you believe I can do that? Yeah, I believe you can do that, sure. So this is the difference between belief and faith. No, the faith is, okay, you get in the wheelbarrow. So you would not get in the wheelbarrow unless you
had to. In medieval terms, it would make the distinction between fides, the thing, the content of your belief. You can affirm that these propositions are true. And fiducia, your commitment to the things that you believe. So fides is, yeah, you can balance across there. Fiducia, I'll get in.
And
go. That's a good distinction, very important distinction, because authentic Christianity would say that you need both.
Now, see, I could see a person, if they say, I have faith in God and I hope it's true, versus the person that just says, I hope it's true, a person says, I hope it's true, that just seems like they're kind of just hoping for the better, but a person says, I have faith in God and I hope it's true, I mean, the hope just kind of follows automatically.
Yeah.
But then the faith actually implies that they're actually actively doing something.
I think what Poyman would say in his defense is, you know, because this is the criticism that the hierarchy of the church would make against him. I'm not a Roman Catholic, but I'm reading myself into this debate. The hierarchy of the church would say, you know, look, Louis, you may have hope, but if you don't have faith in God, your hope is not great. And he would say, look, the truth of the matter is, I don't have faith. Christian doctrine, even though often ridiculed, is not self-contradictory. It makes sense, but I just don't believe it. But I do hope it's true. And he's hoping that that's enough.
Yeah. You're done. I mean, 3 seconds, you want to respond to that, or we can just start.
Well, there's, yeah, I can see some different uses of the words of faith there. Like, there's putting your faith in something like God or the Bible, and then there's like the Christian faith, which could be all the doctrines and creeds and everything. So it's easy to mumble and jumble all that together. So.
It's very many different meanings. In fact, well, there's lots.
Yeah, definitely. All right, guys. We're going to get right into it. Important thing here, I say this all the time because it's so easy, and I'm Italian and uber passionate about things, so I'm always fired up. I don't really operate outside the fired up range, but I try. If you could do me and these gentlemen and the police a huge benefit and just try and keep it as cordial as possible, I know that you believe whatever you believe very passionately, and I encourage you to continue doing that, but we'll try our best not to laugh or yell or point or get out of hand. We want to respect everybody's different viewpoints because we all know we already all don't believe the exact same things. And we're going to hopefully still live and have a good day tomorrow and continue on doing that. So,
and we also want to try to have an interchange and really talk and,
That's fun.
Just try to shut you down.
Yeah, so this is where we have the...
So who wants to come to our sponsored hot seat? Anybody have any questions? The lady in raised her hand first, so we're going to go first come, first serve.
Sponsored hot seat.
Come on down. I know, we should have sponsored it.
Now, are you filming this thing? Should you somebody be directing the camera toward her?
Yeah, this is the Pepsi hot seat.
Yeah, we can. Major opportunity.
Hey, keep the chair in here, though.
Oh, then come in closer with this.
What was her name?
My name's Karen Garst.
Karen Garst, what is your question?
And make sure you speak to the back of the audience here, too.
Well, I took math instead of philosophy, so I'll start out with that. I think mystery is a great thing. I think awe of nature is a great thing. I'm a mother, and when I had a baby, I was in awe of that process. I don't know how the universe came about, but I do know, as a woman, I hope it's not the God of the Bible. I don't know if there's any more misogynistic, patriarchal suppression of women in a book that is stronger than the Bible. The church would tell me that baby I had was conceived in sin and bore from its birth sin and evil. As a woman, I know that book was written by men. And it was written by men because of historical facts of Indo-Europeans, warrior class on their horses and chariots, coming in and invading the lands that hitherto had believed in the mother goddess.
I'm going to encourage you to bring it to a questionable point.
Well, why would any woman want to believe in the God that's in the Bible that allows killing of children and the creation of children as sin?
Good question.
And I, you know, notice there's three men up here talking.
philosophy, on that last point, philosophy is unfortunately.
Yeah, speak about to the.
On the last point, as a discipline, philosophy is less gender balanced than practically any other social area. You do almost as well in engineering as you do in philosophy and representation. So why would you turn to the Bible? Why would you turn to Christianity if you're a woman? It's an empirical question. Why do women find in Jesus Christ the great liberator? You have to ask them.
I was born in a Lutheran Norwegian home. I believed in the Bible because that's what I was taught.
Uh-huh.
If I would have been born in China, I'd have been a Buddhist. And if I would have been born in Pakistan, I would be a Muslim. And if I was born in India, I was a Hindu. And that indoctrination was very good.
So,
but it's a lie.
So then your claim, I'm interpreting then, this is your claim, that the only reason women find the God of the Bible to be liberating is that they were born within a certain milieu and trained into it. In which case, then I would point you to the cases of the conversions where they come to Christianity specifically because they find Jesus to be the great liberator.
I'm 64, and I intend for the rest of my life to tell women that they need to be fully human to be released from the shackles of God.
Okay. Then you have a mission.
I do.
Do you have any other questions?
No.
We can come back to this stuff later if we end up having not too many questions, but I know we had four. I'm actually going to try and go in order. I'll get to it. This gentleman, then you, then you, then you, then you. So. I'm trying to keep it to about 4 minutes.
Just wanted to ask Bernie here. You were using the metaphor of gravity. Do you have faith in gravity?
I didn't use the metaphor of gravity, but.
You talked about dropping.
Oh, right. Okay, do I have faith in gravity? I'm not sure what you mean by that. I think there's the effects of gravity. I mean, people, scientists, as I understand it, don't even know what the underlying foundation of gravity is. There could be gravitons or something. But science knows what gravity is as far as an effect and how to work with it and deal with it, but there's a lot of mystery there still. So I have faith that gravity is always going to work, if that's what you mean. According to Newtonian laws, is that what you mean?
That's what I'm getting at. I mean, science has no explanation at this point as to why gravity works. Mm-hmm. So it is a mystery in that regard. The gravitational constant is actually quite variable. It's one of the least well-defined constants there is. So I'm wondering if, and you brought up that some people, you know, believed angels might be pushing it down. So, and you referred to naturalistic laws, but it doesn't seem all science has done so far is to describe it, the effects of gravity, but nothing in terms of explaining why it works or how it works. So.
Yes, science, this is very important to understand that science is in the business of understanding the mysteries. And so when you say science doesn't know anything about a certain subject, of course, that's why scientists are working on it. Scientists are creating new hypotheses exactly on the things that they don't know about. Nobody's studying things they already know. When you get a PhD, you're trying to make new territory, break new ground. And there's a lot of mysteries out there. So
it seems to me, correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems to me that you have, at this point, faith that gravity will behave in a certain way with no good explanation as to why it would work.
The good explanation is history. I mean, we observe it. If we observe gravity not operating in a very consistent manner, then we wouldn't believe it. But when you see it over hundreds of years or whatever, operating in a certain way, there's no good reason to doubt it until you get reason to doubt it.
Even though you can't explain it.
Of course, you can't explain, yeah.
So
what I'm saying is, if you don't ever see an anomaly, it's good to think it's going to always be the same.
What it sounds to me like is what you're saying is I have faith in it because of this history.
Sure. So, exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like I said, I think scientists put faith in the hypotheses, and sometimes they put it in too long. They should dump it when there's this confirming evidence, and I think the best scientists do. They may fall in love with their hypothesis, but they're also able to change it. Einstein was famous for holding on to theories too long, and sometimes he said he was wrong and he was actually right. I mean, there's all kinds of funny twists and turns in there. So,
thank you.
Satisfied? Yeah. All right, gentlemen in the back.
He's comfortable, man. He's a great guy.
I'll volunteer for your hot seat for you.
This one's sponsored by...
Yeah, we're going to do something next time.
Kung Fu Panda.
For Phil.
Okay. And what is your name?
Pat.
Pat.
And
making everybody famous.
35 years born again Pentecostal.
Okay.
Now non-believer. Can you distinguish or acknowledge a big difference between belief in God and belief in what people have proclaimed about the nature and existence of God, and especially like the feeling, you have a feeling is one of the evidences for God. People have told me that it was God. I believe now that it is a biological, psychological phenomenon, and just how can you have direct faith in God? Isn't just about all of it something that someone has told you that could well be the invention of a mind?
I think what great deal of that I want to agree with. Remember, I stressed that the argument that I presented was only that our experiences of mystery actually can count for something. And I emphasized several times that it might, that it counts for something still has to be weighed against many other things, including arguments of various kinds. And also, another kind of defeater that you're mentioning here is that I may have been enculturated in such a way to interpret my experiences in a very biased way, right? So I've been taught to interpret this evidence, it's real evidence at least you're with me on that, I hope. It's real evidence, but I've been enculturated in such a way as to interpret it in a very biased way, so that I've got to be, it seems to me I've got to be skeptical about it.
I accept it as evidence that you have felt something.
Yes.
You have felt something that seems mysterious to you, but that in no way means that it's God. I see it as a story that you believe in triggers. It causes an emotional experience.
Okay,
it triggers
now the
chemicals, and now you get a feeling.
Now the question is you're leaning. Let's say I don't want to put you in a bad boat, but you're leaning toward Freud's view. And he says, "Look, I've got an absolute knockdown argument for all this stuff. Ahead of time, we can rule out all that experience." Now, I would agree that we ought to question that experience. We ought to be skeptical about that experience. But that's not the same as ruling it out.
But still, it is evidence for the possibility of God rather than the existence of God.
Well, along with a lot of other things, it becomes evidence for the existence of God. See, now, in neuroscience, one of the big promises out there right now is that we're going to explain high-order brain... notice that we slip into brain language. We're going to explain high-order mental phenomena in the terms of brain functioning from the bottom up. The reductive program of neuroscience is one of the most biggest promissory notes out there. Maybe it's true, but we haven't got, there are miles and miles between the stuff at the neural level and the stuff that they say that they can explain. I would be deeply skeptical.
Is there any point that science could get to that would dissuade you from your belief?
Oh, yeah. If it's not possible to have counter evidence, and this is an important point for some religious believers, if it is impossible to have counter evidence to your belief, your belief is actually vacuous. The example I often give in class is the famous 1880s woman reporter. What's her name? Nellie Bly. Nellie Bly gets her, she's famous for, she investigates tenements and all kinds of bad things. She's really brave. She's going to investigate the New York City insane asylum, 1880s. She had, being Nellie Bly, she has herself admitted. After a couple days, she doesn't want to be there. So she goes to the person and says, "I'm Nellie Bly, the famous reporter. You need to let me out." They didn't believe her. They had a theory. Anybody in here is crazy. And they would not allow anything that she said to count against their theory. Did that make their theory strong? Of course not. If a religious person has a theory or a hypothesis, whatever you want to call it, of faith in God, and nothing may count against it, it's actually vacuous. It says nothing wrong.
So what would be, to answer his question?
When Peter asked me this question, how could I persuade this Peter Boghossian, acquaintance of mine, we're not close friends, but we help each other out. What would be the evidence against the existence of God? I said, bones. Bones of Jesus. The Christian faith stands and falls with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If you show me bones, but what's the evidentiary problem? Of course there's a huge evidentiary problem. Well, I said, if there is no possible counter evidence, then something is vacuous.
They just found the bones.
Of Jesus?
And the ossuary, whatever.
The ossuary of somebody called James. And because... it's a possibility, though. Now, the evidentiary problem is huge. But if I became convinced that this is an ossuary of a guy named Jesus who was crucified on Pontius Pilate, I'd go become a Jew or something.
What is the evidentiary problem with a great miracle worker with thousands of followers, great controversy, great concern from Rome and the Jewish leaders. So many miracles you can't fit them in the book. Why was that never recorded during his lifetime? Why do we have to rely on things 100 years later, 50 years later? And anything, and I've read the Josh McDowell books that are absolute, as far as I'm concerned, a black mark on Christianity for the apologetics. Why don't you see an evidentiary problem that something that phenomenal in a place and time so well recorded just didn't end up, except for later claims made later in retrospect?
Well, we have to talk about the history of the oral transmission of what's called the tradition of Jesus. There's a lot of technical stuff there.
We're going to give you a minute, and then we
can come back. I'm taking too much time.
Yeah,
but I would like to say for you, I'm not passionate about my atheism, but I am passionate about the 35 years of my adult life that I worse than wasted because people convinced me that the feeling I had inside was from God and not just something they manipulated so they could control my life.
That's too bad.
To me specifically?
Because you said we're all passionate about it?
Yeah.
If something came up that disproved my non-belief, it's fine. I'd rather know the truth than go on in the delusion that there is no spiritual realm. But I am passionate about how a lot of people are helped, but so many people are controlled and manipulated by other people with getting them to believe that they have some kind of connection or work from God.
I just appreciate the candor with which you speak.
Thank you for enduring.
Very helpful, Pat.
I want to make a short comment on this interchange. One of the things Pat talked about was, you know, could we have these feelings and emotions and stuff that are triggering these feelings? And I want to say, when I was an evangelical Christian, I used to read the Bible and pray to God. And when I used to read the Bible, some passages used to strike me in the heart, like, wow, what a special tug that is. It's a special feeling. It's like, wow, that's a God feeling. And then sometimes I'd watch a movie that was really touching, and I'd get that same feeling, and it bothered me. It was like, wait a minute, that's supposed to be God's territory, you know? So that would happen a couple of times. And since I left the faith, like just recently I saw the movie Interstellar, and it talked about, you know, it was very big on a relationship between a father and his daughter. And that one hit me a couple of times, you know, and I got that special feeling again. So it's kind of interesting how I used to reserve that feeling just for God. Because I conflated it because I got from reading the Bible initially, and now I see that it's just an emotional feeling.
Sir, what was your name?
Or maybe it's God calling you back.
From the Intel fellow. What was your name?
I just have a real quick comment.
Absolutely, go for it.
Your story about Russell's village, you said it's impossible?
Yeah.
Not if the barber's a woman.
There's another assumption. Barber is a man, and that he lives in the village. I didn't say that part. That's required to, because you could solve it if somebody outside the village came in.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like that you're paying attention. I don't want to remind. I believe, was it you that had the question?
Sure. Can I ask like two brief questions to each of the speakers, or limit?
That's fine.
No. There's a requirement. If you're going to ask two, you have to come.
Yeah. Have to take a walk.
Scoot the chair in, or he'll be out of the picture.
Yeah. What was your name?
My name is Brahim.
Brahim.
Awesome. Don't move out. You're getting out of the picture. Move back in.
Yeah, scoot in. Yeah.
So my questions basically are for you is, you know, a lot of the great scientific thinkers historically believed in some notion of God, whether it's a prime mover or, you know, some kind of deistic notion. Some of the great thinkers, Newton, Galileo, Einstein, etc. And my assessment is that they were tuning to something. I'm not sure exactly what it is, that thing is. Perhaps it's the infinity of the universe or whatever. So my question for you would be, do you think it's possible for people to, for people who have too much faith in the scientific method to reduce the world, to commit a fallacy of reductionism in the sense of assuming that there are a finite number of problems and that they're all solvable, when it is possible that there are an infinite number of problems and that there's something very vitalizing, very life-affirming about seeking that infinite possibility of an infinite number of problems. So is it possible to take science too far insofar as reducing life?
No, number one, you can never take science too far, and the reason why is because science progresses. And a scientist who screws up in some way, like limiting it too much, is going to get overshadowed by another scientist who makes a breakthrough. And all the scientists want to make a breakthrough. So they are all open to everything that's reasonable, and they all want to shut out what's unreasonable. And the more you are closer to the truth, what's reasonable, the more advancement you're going to make. And this is why there's so much confidence in science, is because of all the progress it has made. And as it goes, it destroys religious beliefs. You know, like, you know, that the Earth is the center of the world, for example, or the universe, for example, or, you know. And as far as the ancient scientists, it's like, my point is, why would you...
Well, Einstein's not that ancient.
Yeah, but what... Look at the modern scientists. There are brilliant scientists today alive that were just as smart as Einstein. Why don't you talk about the living ones, for example?
Well, there may be some brilliant living scientists that believe in God. I don't know. I don't. My knowledge of the field is not that extensive. But I feel like you haven't really addressed the question. Is what were they driven by? I mean, surely they weren't stupid.
Well, yeah, but they're also... Like, for example, Einstein, when quantum mechanics was being discovered, you know, he said, oh, God does not play with dice. And then, you know, the counterpoint was Niels Bohr said, well, you shouldn't tell God what to do. It turns out that Einstein was wrong about that. It is a dice.
Yeah, on the quantum level,
but
it seems
like,
wrong,
yeah.
But on the macro level, he's right.
Right,
so it depends.
But what I'm saying is these scientists, all these ancient scientists, they had a limited information. Some of them really going way back. I mean, children nowadays in grade school know more about them because of the common science breakthroughs we make. Like, DNA has been decoded since the year 2000, so we have all this information now that the previous scientists in biology didn't know about. So that's what I'm saying. I mean, if you're a Christian, and you believe that you can be a good scientist, and I think you ought to appeal to a living scientist, somebody like Francis Collins, for example. But then Francis Collins, he upsets other Christians because, of course, he accepts evolution, but then, you know, that hurts them and their other beliefs. So it's like, I say don't go to these safe, dead scientists, but look at modern scientists, you know? If they're Christian, atheist, whatever, look at the modern ones because they know everything the ancient ones did. There's nothing the ancients knew that these modern ones don't, nothing whatsoever. But the modern ones know a ton of more things than the ancient dead ones ever knew. I mean, it's incredible. You never want to go to some dead scientist, what they believed a couple hundred years ago, as if you can get some kind of insight from that.
I'm going to have you move your second question, if you don't mind.
Sure, and kind of along similar lines, it will say I have a profound spiritual experience in the woods, I have some kind of profound experience of love and connectedness, and I feel, you know, wonderful. And this experience is very real to me, it's a very life-changing experience, and many of the, you know, great religious leaders had experiences of something like that, like Muhammad in the cave, and, you know, Jesus in the garden and all these things. So, this is my problem with those kinds of experiences. It's not that they don't constitute legitimate evidence, is how can they be legitimately generalized? That's my problem with it. So,
right.
What I'm saying is the danger is I can take that experience and I can mystify it and generalize it and use it to my own advantage. And even worse, I think, is that if I genuinely believe that my personal experience, something that's deeply personal, something that only I experience, applies to others, I may be oppressing their ability to have spiritual experiences. So the question would be, is mystification a real danger of these kinds of experiences, and how do you avoid that kind of danger?
Okay, first of all, you're saying, what are the guidelines for me if I'm a spiritual seeker? And I would say, seek, let other people, not impose on other people, but ask people to help you. Ask people to help you along, other people who have their experiences. That doesn't mean you turn off your mind and believe everything that they say, but you compare what you've experienced with what they have experienced. If someone says, some religious tradition says, and this is what we know because of this, and so it means that we can destroy people, we can put down women, we can kill people. I think you have a pretty good reason right there. I mean, if it's morally repugnant, it's not a good way to go. Right? So
But how do you decide what's morally repugnant? That's culturally bound.
that we're leaving our topic for a very, I would strongly disagree. Morals are not culturally bound. Cultural relativism is a bad philosophical position. That doesn't, I'm not saying that culture doesn't affect what we think about morals, but there are moral truths that are super cultural. We can go to there some other time. But the point is, you don't just have your religious experience, you have other people's religious experience, which you can access through community, and you have non-religious things like moral guidelines that can help you guide your seeking too. So be an active seeker. Pray. How about that?
Okay. Can I give a quick comment on that last part? You know, sometimes like a Christian or somebody religious might fast for like 3 days and then say, I got a vision from God, and people might say, oh, really? I mean, are they really impressed that they got a vision after you stress the brain and the body from fasting? Maybe they should say, well, of course you got a vision. Why is that something interesting? Or like an Indian taking peyote for a religious service, and they get a vision of dancing gods and all this stuff, and it means all this. I mean, it sounds like, according to you, Phil, that's valid evidence, because it's a vision. I mean,
well,
that's drug-induced. A
book by an atheistic philosopher named Jonathan Lear came out in 2006, called, having to do with hope. And he tells the story of Chief Plenicou, the last great chief of the Crow people, who did this sort of thing. He went out as a 10-year-old, 9-year-old, to receive his vision from God. And in order to induce his vision from God, he actually cut off part of his digit. Many young Crow young men lost parts of their fingers in order to induce these kind of visions. So it's just self-induced nonsense, right? And surely the atheistic philosopher Jonathan Lear is going to come to that conclusion, right? He doesn't. I'm not going to try to tell the whole story. Instead, I would urge you to look at an open-minded atheist, Jonathan Lear, and his treatment of Chief Plenicou's religious experience and how actually that religious experience helped save the Crow people.
I think that's pretty sad that you think it's a good thing that people cut their fingers off because of a vision. That sounds pretty
good. The rest of you, did I say that? Did I even imply that? Good enough.
I thought you said it was beneficial.
The vision that he had, according to Lear, was beneficial to the people. The fact that it was induced through this kind of stuff, I mean, that's part of their culture. I don't know what to say about that. I wouldn't do it.
I think it should be denounced as a problem of religion gone astray.
This gentleman, and then I'm going to start, I'll start the new queue up as soon as we're off for the Harley Davidson Nazi.
Oh,
now
we've got the Harley Davidson thing.
Hello.
Name?
We're
Scott.
Okay. So I'm going to actually ask you a question. It's kind of out of your book.
Oh.
So.
What did you got? Is this from chapter 2 of Why Faith is a Virtue?
Mm-hmm.
Aha! Eight so, different versions of faith. Here we go.
Are you from France and do you read the science fiction?
Taking the fifth on that one. So I just want to make sure, hopefully I'm understanding part of this. I guess that's kind of leading up to my question. So I guess, is it correct in saying faith in God is warranted because it creates good within the individual? It creates good?
No. Faith 8, if you've read the thing,
mm-hmm.
is believing in something when people who you know have intellectual respect for, either
mm-hmm.
goes in or Bernie, don't believe it. So in the typical case, now it might be other case, but in the typical case, faith is believing something when you have prima facie reason to not believe it. I've got quite a pretty sick prima facie reason not to believe in God.
Mm-hmm.
But so faith is a virtue then, if it helps you to get the, now I'm using McIntyre here, get the, if it helps, generally, not in every possible case, generally helps you to get the internal goods of some practice. Now, in the book, I don't address religious faith until chapter 8. I'm dealing with other versions of faith. So in chapter 8, I do argue that religious faith, it's my religious faith, at least religious faith like mine or something like that, because I'm personally interested, can be a virtue. Yeah. So that's why. So Bernie gives the typical examples of all these religious people who do terrible things.
Okay.
Actually, if you weigh up all the murders of the 20th century, the atheists are way ahead of the religious believers.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay, so I guess that kind of breaks that.
Hitler was a Christian.
What?
I said Hitler was a Christian.
And if you count him as a Christian,
Hitler
you still
was a
have
Christian.
Stalin and Pol Pot and Idi Amin on the other side.
What about modern?
So I guess here's my question though.
Thanks,
so,
Scott has a question.
Yes,
yeah,
Scott's
sorry,
question.
Sorry. So here's the quote out of the book.
Yeah.
More to the point of this book, moral good reflects something of God's goodness, human justice, kindness, temperance, and love. All of them imperfect are good because they reflect God's perfect justice, kindness, temperance, and love.
Here is something that I'm getting from Robert Adams, but
okay.
I agree with.
Okay, yeah, I assume you agree with that.
Yeah.
So I guess my kind of question is, and part of my question is, by that argument, then moral bads reflect something of God's badness, human injustice, cruelty, intolerance, and hate. All
no,
imperfect.
Doesn't follow at all.
So it doesn't, but you're assuming that the moral goods we see are a reflection of God's goodness, then why couldn't we say the moral bads we see are a reflection of God's badness?
Well, because God is not bad.
Ah, okay, so that's okay, that's okay. So that's what I would contend, is that if you're gonna, if that author is gonna essentially say we're gonna see God as the ultimate good based on the good we see in the world, then we can say the exact same thing about him
no,
being
that's
bad.
That's not the argument. He's trying to give Adams is trying to give a theological, philosophical, theory of how we should understand good. So
mm-hmm.
his book is, that particular book is called Finite and Infinite Goods.
Mm-hmm.
And interestingly, mm-hmm. he has a chapter on the bad.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to push you into the literature. You're taking
okay.
the literature seriously, and Adams is he's good. I'm low fish. He's
okay.
one of the big philosophers in the country. So I strongly encourage you to read
okay.
that book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. That was
satisfied?
Kind of, well, yeah, I guess it was gonna, here's my question, I guess, if we were gonna accept that argument of the bad
sure.
and for good, is that, therefore, couldn't we change the topic of the discussion to, is faith in the evil God warranted? I think we would all agree, no. Therefore, if God can be good and evil, is faith still warranted? But
right. You're having questions about what's the metaphysical status of evil, right? And huge question, we haven't got time to do that, but you're on the right track of an interesting question.
Thank you.
Yeah,
just one little quick comment too. I think one thing you're hitting on there is sometimes people say, they'll say like, God created evolution, God, you know, you accept evolution that humans evolved from other animals, Phil.
Mm-hmm.
And so they would say, yeah, we praise God for that, but then it's like, well, what about the negative things of evolution, like all the pain and suffering and killing and all that stuff? Sometimes, you know, it's like, are you looking at the whole picture, or are you just looking at the positives only? I think that's what the question was, is are you cherry-picking and just looking at positive things and saying, oh, that's all for God, and the bad things, oh, well, that's not a credit to God. We only credit the good stuff to God, and the bad stuff, well, to be explained away.
Two debates ago, we've been in this business. Two debates ago, we talked about this. And if you want to, we can do it again sometime. I don't think that the argument from evil is a good argument against the existence of God.
And that's apparently all he's going to say about
that.
Yeah,
we spent 2 hours on it, and we should, but we're not going
to
spend 20 minutes.
If you have questions,
question.
I'm going to, you, and then we'll do that girl in the back.
Okay. My name's Heath. Hello. I have a question for both of you, Phil.
Sure.
The prohibition of spiritual feelings, it's hard to kind of go against that, because the way that our society's moved, things since World War I, World War II, whichever movement you want to pick. What I'm most curious about, and you touched on it a little bit too, is so you have a valid religious spiritual experience. Where'd you make the jump from that spiritual experience to then a particular religion? So you can have like a valid experience. Obviously, we all have those experiences of mystery, of wonder, and awe.
Mm-hmm.
Why choose? Why go to one particular?
Okay, first
place?
Of all, minor point. I'm not sure everybody does have experiences of mystery and awe.
Okay.
I wish that they did, but some people don't. And you're exactly right. I have said nothing to take you from this evidence counts to this conclusion.
Yeah, okay.
So there's an awful lot of work to do. Although I have emphasized how difficult it will be to get from this evidence counts to this particular conclusion. I'm just up against people who want to say that evidence doesn't count at all.
Yeah.
Pay no attention to it.
Thanks so much. Can I ask me? Well,
absolutely.
No, that's the great answer.
Yeah,
thank you.
One question.
Yeah. So, forgive me for doing this. So you said you live your life with no logical fallacies, I think it was, no contradictions. I'm a phenomenologist, so logic is ridiculous to me altogether. But
you're a what?
A phenomenologist.
Okay.
So as far as science is making advancements and progress, then I refer you to Hegel and Kant and the gradual development of the religious experience in society over time to lead us to a God eventually. I mean, I'm assuming you're familiar with Hegel. So what you said about science is the same thing that religion does. It changes, it advances. The same way science makes mistakes as false or ridiculous endeavors, as does religion. There's a certain amount of, you know, it's a weak thing to say against a religion.
Well, can I reply right there?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Science, I think you can kind of say with some understanding of what that is. When you say religion, that's a very confusing term because you could have theistic religions and even atheistic religions. For example, Buddhism, and some people say even secular humanism is a religion. Mm-hmm. So when you say religion, and in some religions, their young earth creations, for example, this is a very literal Bible, you know, they're not going to change it at all. If they want to change, there's other people left behind, they maintain that. So it's not a matter of religion. You have to talk about a specific religion. I don't get offended. I ascribe to secular humanism as a belief system. If you call that a religion, it doesn't bother me at all. And if you say, well, you know, if you did call that a religion, of course it changes. It changes with knowledge all the time. We do what we think is best. We think what's logical. If we think we have a belief statement that's wrong, we'll change it if we have to. But
so in the same way, to interrupt you, there are different groups. There's different scientists. I'm not going to mention climate change and that ridiculousness, but not all scientists are following the same trend. It's not just one group of people all going, let's do this and move in this direction. There's many different movements in many different directions within science. The same way there's many different religious movements, there's many different groups in that. The argument doesn't stand ground.
Well,
so if you look at either,
well, there is
the same
one
issue.
Scientific method where you create the hypothesis and you create a test, and you look for evidence to confirm it or deny it.
Uh-huh.
You know, the scientists don't have different factions like Christians, where you have Pentecostals and Baptists and Catholics, and they're saying they're heretics. They don't do that in science. They don't say they're heretics, unless it's something that, they don't say heretics, but there could be different factions trying to figure out something that's totally unknown, and they have all these different ideas. But usually the empirical evidence rules it out, and you don't have factions in science. It doesn't matter if you're a Baptist or a Catholic in science. It's totally irregardless. But in religion, it makes all the difference in the world if you're a Catholic or a Baptist.
That's coming across.
It just shows there's no grounding whatsoever in religion, but there is a tremendous grounding in science that no matter what your religion is, you can. Scientists agree about evolution as scientific consensus, and it doesn't matter if they're Hindus, Baptists, Muslims, anything.
Okay, well, there's consensus within religions as well.
Like what, for example?
Unity.
What?
Unity.
What do you mean unity? Those
unity.
Guys are the out-group and we have the in-group.
I don't want to go into that too much because I have another question I want to ask you, but I've looked at this. If you consider other religions besides Christianity, etc., there's a consensus amongst religions as far as a godhead or a god figure, etc.
No. There's some atheistic religions. There's some Buddhists that are atheistic.
I don't want to get bogged down on that. It's just, I would ask you to look at science and religion in the same way when you're looking at the advancement and progress of a time. That's all.
Okay, well,
it's more of a request because it...
Well, you know what, at some point, I mean, Christianity has evolved. Like, for example, Phil, he might be called an evolutionary creationist. And, you know, 200 years ago, or maybe 1,000 years ago, everybody was a young Earth creationist, or almost all of them. So in that way, it matures because of science, gives them more insight, so they have to interpret the Bible differently. Why are they interpreting differently? Because of science.
Okay, so the other question I wanted to ask you, well, statement, is you keep mentioning logical fallacies, but you said gravity can explain because it's always happened, and that rings a bell with some logical fallacy for me.
What's the logical fallacy?
Is it, what is it?
Appeal to ignorance.
No, not appeal to ignorance, it's the time one. It's always been done this way, so it'll always continue.
Tradition, yeah, there's a conservative fallacy that this is right because it's always been done that way, and then there's the opposite one where this is right because it's different.
It's not a valid, it's not, within that context of logical fallacies, to say gravity will put our faith in it, because it's always happened, just has no water, it doesn't stand.
Why would you doubt gravity though? I mean, you have no reason to doubt, you have no reason to doubt gravity, and you do have reason to believe it's gonna be consistent because of the evidence. So you have reason to think it's gonna be consistent, and you have reason to reject that it's gonna change. If we ever saw one example of where gravity changes, then you would be perfectly reasonable to say it's foolish to think it's always constant.
I'm no expert. I thought we had a person who testified that gravity does change.
Yeah.
It's going to shift.
No, he said there was different gravitational constants. I don't know what he's referring to, but if there's different constants...
Well, the point where it's made was...
I mean, that's science, that's science.
Within your own framework of logic, that doesn't sound... You know that, I know that, that's it.
Yeah,
go on.
Okay, I didn't understand your point on that one.
But empirically, you can show that gravity exists. You can't show that God empirically exists. So we can measure how fast something falls. We've measured, even though the constant wobbles, like what this guy was saying a little bit, there's still something measurable. Like, everything falls at a constant rate, we know that. So that is at least one piece of evidence for gravity versus, I guess, God might be a personal religious experience, but.
There's all kinds of questions in philosophy and science here that we can go off into. Bernie has certain views about the scientific method, I think, are mostly right, but a little bit oversimplified. But I think we ought to spend time on other questions that people have.
And thank you.
Yeah,
come on up. Thank you.
Sponsored by?
We don't know.
Hi.
And what is your name?
My name is Kate. I also took math in school. I got my undergrad in athletic training, so sports medicine was my deal, and a minor in biopsychology. So it would have been frowned upon if I wrote my thesis paper without scientific evidence to support it, essentially. For the first 23 years of my life, I was a non-believer, but for the past 2 years, I was Christian, and I've never felt more loved in my life. So my question is for Mr. Dehler. There's something in medicine, assuming you accept the premise that diagnosticians are modern day scientists. Whenever you go see a physician or an athletic trainer or a chiropractor, anybody in the medical field, they'll write what's called a soap note, and that's how they keep their documentation. And it stands for subjective, objective assessment and their plan to treat you. So again, I'm nervous, I'm sorry. I don't get in front of people. It's saying that you accept the premise that physicians are modern day scientists.
Yeah, yeah.
How is their subjective portion of what they do any different than the subjective of other areas of life?
Well, so basically, what they're doing is they're trying to take a scientific approach. What are you going to measure? They don't have a machine, so they're trying to create things. Like, for example, they might say, you have a pain level. Let's say there's a 1 to 5 pain level. What pain level do you have? There's no machine or anything, but they're doing the best they can. So it's subjective only because they don't have more technology. If they had more technology, they would use it. So they're using whatever they can. Notice what they're not doing is just going based on just thoughts and imagination and stuff. I mean, they are trying to do diagnostics. I wanted to say that you said at first too that you're a Christian in the last 2 years and you felt this incredible love. Mm-hmm. I did too. I felt the incredible love too. It's incredible. And I now see it as a delusion because it's not based on facts. I mean, if you were in the desert and very thirsty, you would see an oasis and you would swear it's an oasis. It's a delusion though. And that's why I had to, say, even though I felt it, it's a delusion. Just like the Mormon felt the burning in the bosom when he prayed directly for God for that specifically, and specifically got it, I believe that's a delusion too. So I know exactly what you're talking about. I also have it, but I am not gonna go for what feels good. I'm gonna go for what I think is true. So it's truth number one.
So kind of continuing with my medical metaphor here. Mm-hmm. There are things called referred pain. So things mm-hmm. like cursine, where you feel pain in your left shoulder, but really you have a problem in your abdomen.
Okay.
There's an organ on top. So mm-hmm. the pain is very real,
mm-hmm.
but it's in a different
right.
area.
Right.
And actually, I mean, there are theories, but nobody knows why.
Mm-hmm.
That's a subjective piece of evidence that could literally be used to prove something else is real, that something else happened.
I don't know about that, because I mean, there's like amputees who have no arm and yet they feel a pain in their wrist,
mm-hmm.
and they have no wrist. So what you're doing is you're when you're relaying this, you're relaying scientific facts that people have a pain here, but it's really over here. See, what you're doing is you're going to scientific facts, which is a good thing. You're not taking them literally. You know their pain is not there, or you're considering that. You only know that because of science, from what science has figured out from clinical trials and tests and feedback and all that stuff. You don't know that from feelings and gut feelings and things like that. So these are all examples of how scientific thinking is helping you do your job better. So,
and
yeah.
I'm not a debater.
My
question was, how is subjective evidence in medicine, how does that differ from subjective evidence
okay.
in other
yeah.
in other departments of life?
Well, I'll tell you one story too. There's this famous story. There's a critical thinking book that's a classic used in all these courses in universities usually. And there's this one story about this one scientist. He was really famous, and I don't know if it's Sweden or where it was, but he actually got a whole movement going, and he had some kind of weird theory. And basically, he had people saying, like, you know, what color is this thing? They would say it's red or reddish blue or something. And because it was so subjective, the science was all messed up, and they had finally one scientist from America just came and just humiliated them with an experiment, you know, to show that it's wrong. And basically the whole story is about how subjectivity kills science, and science is in the whole business of removing subjectivity as much as possible. So for example, so normally in a scientific thing, they don't want to say things like, what color do you think this is, red or blue? They want to get an instrument on there to actually measure the wavelength, because that way it removes the subjectivity. So subjectivity is trying to be removed. But in the medical situation, you got to deal with what you have, and that's all you have. So you have to ask diagnostics, and then you think logically, what could all this mean? And you know things like the pain might be here, even though they say it's down there or whatever. So
I want to follow up on that. If the goal of science is to get rid of subjectivity, then we really should long for the day when we don't have doctors and we just have robots?
Well, doctors are not really science. You have car technicians. Doctors are technicians for the body. They're trying to fix things. Scientists are making breakthroughs and trying to determine reality.
So what we want is to get past this day of murkiness and move on to the better day of having science take care of us and have robots take care of us and not have doctors to deal with all that personal stuff in between, but get rid of that.
Well, it's called scientific thinking. It's not so much we need science, and we need scientific thinking, which means logic and reasoning and data and evidence. And
so now we want the doctor, but we want the doctor to be cold and tough,
cold.
Without subjectivity, there's no poetry, there's no art, there's
no well, hold on. What
flair,
Phil just mentioned cold. I mean, cold has nothing to do with it. Cold, if you're looking at data, it doesn't mean you're cold.
So doctor who loves his patient is better than the doctor who doesn't, other things being equal.
I had breast cancer, and I want the doctor who knows and detects it.
other things.
And I don't care whether they love me or they hate me. I'm glad that he didn't try to bleed me like they would have 200 years ago.
Right.
Okay?
Remember the caveat. Other things being equal, do you want the doctor who is subjectively cares for you or the man who doesn't?
Yeah, yeah. All things being equal, I want somebody who's loving, sure.
Okay.
And why is that? Because it feels good.
But it has nothing to do with medicine.
It makes me feel good.
Thank you.
Yeah. We're going to wrap up. Any last questions that you can ask these guys afterwards? Anybody? Anything? Anybody? Nope. Good deal.
Well, thank you for coming out. It's a cold night.
I'm sorry. Was there a comment that I missed?
Well, he mentioned too. He goes, well, then what about poetry and stuff? Right? Well, you know, like you're just in the scientific method, then what use is poetry? Well, I would say poetry, I don't think that's much use for determining reality. I don't think you use poetry to determine
truth.
Well,
if you say science is in the business of removing subjectivity, then the entire science of psychology would be erased, and you'd have a lot of scientific psychologists, you know, being very angry with you because they're in the business of how to use science to improve subjectivity, to help people improve their subjective sense of well-being, feel happier, report being in a better life. It's a science of subjectivity. If you're saying science is in the business of removing subjectivity, then the entire science of psychology will be erased. It's that's exactly what I'm afraid that science will do, is that it will reduce things. It will take things, existential parts of human life, and say these things don't exist.
You know, it should be obvious. If you're trying to do an experiment and you want to have it reproducible and you want to get good results, you can't have subjective data like how many grams did you put in that cup? 3 or 4, whatever it felt like. How do you reproduce that? You can't reproduce that.
But even in studying the mind, you were trying to test something. Like, I just read something today about this Morgolin's disease. It happened to be in an essay where people believe that they are itching all over. You want to deal with that as a psychologist because you want to get at what is making them think that. When you objectively know it's not true, but they still have a problem because they're scratching
right,
themselves.
But the only effective treatments for it are cognitive treatments, and cognitive treatments deal strictly with the subject. How are you thinking about the problem?
Right, but your cognitive, when you learn
cognition
about cognitive
is not
behavior,
you
do
grasp.
It based on theory and trying it, and those kind of methods to be sure you're right.
Excuse me, neuroscience helps psychology. Psychology will improve through neuroscience.
Sure.
The better a psychologist you're going to be. I have a nephew studying psychology, and one of the subjects he's struggling with is neuroscience because you want as much science, cold hard science knowledge about the brain as possible to help you with the psychology.
They inform each other.
That's what I'm saying.
You need
to continue this, but we're just going to cap it. So if you have questions, come up and talk with these guys individually.
Or talk to each
but
other.
But continue to talk to each
other.
I don't want to cut you off, but I just want to cap so people can go if they want. Thank you. I would encourage you guys as non-partial. One thing I didn't hear either of them really mention that I think would be very important in this specific conversation, which is why is faith in God warranted, would be, and Bernie brought this up a little bit, which I appreciated, really looking at the definition of faith. I think you should probably look at the definition of faith from both a secular point of view, but if you're talking about it from a religious standpoint and you're going to get as specific as a specific religion, I would have loved to have heard the specific definition of faith as it's used in context from a Christian worldview, because those might be very different and it's very pointed. That was something that wasn't really brought up too much from either side, so as you go out and consider these things on your own, I'd love to see you guys go do that because it might inform further discussions that are germane to this discussion.
How about a 1 minute summary? We said we're going to close with like Phil first, then.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. I just assumed that was
just,
that.
Just like 1 minute.
If you would
just
like to
minute.
Stick around to a 1 minute summary,
okay.
Phil, you're going to knock your socks off.
You've heard this before, so I'll just say it again.
Hold on. Let's have it. We need to have it quiet here so we can. But let's just 2 minutes. Just 1 minute.
2 minutes.
Summary here.
I'm all over the clock. Go for it, Bill.
I think religious experience ought to count as real evidence about the world. I think that the prohibition against counting religious experience depends on promises that science has not made and will not ever make good. And I think our good reasons for it.
There you go. 18 seconds.
Okay. my summary is that I think faith in God is not warranted, just like faith in Darth Vader, Harry Potter, or Zeus Thor, or any of them, especially the Bible God, is not warranted. And the reason why is because, number one, there's no good evidence for it, and number two, the evidence that is usually submitted is a logical fallacy of one sort or another, and I believe, like Phil even is doing that with his number one thing about religious experience being valuable, which I would say is not valuable whatsoever for determining truth, especially when you consider that people on drugs get visions, and Mormons get visions, and all these different people get visions that we know are not true, so... I'll leave it with that.
All right. Thank you, guys.